By the year 1986, some 6 years after Rogier van Otterlo took over from Dolf van der Linden, the transformation of the Metropole Orkest had definitely taken shape. Rogier had recruited many new musicians to take advantage of many of the old-timers reaching retirement age. Jazz repertoire was no problem whatsoever with people like Piet Noordijk, Robbie Langerijs and Evert Overweg, and under Van Otterlo's direction, a completely new rhythm section dedicated to pop music was hired in the persons of Arno van Nieuwenhuizen, Peter Thiehuis, Lex Bolderdijk and Jan Hollestelle. The results became clear very quickly. The Metropole Orkest radiated a new vitality with not only new and younger musicians, but also with new repertoire. Not to be forgotten, however, was the growing role of Rob Pronk as composer, arranger, and frequent guest conductor of the orchestra. Particularly of the recordings made for the Koch Jazz label with leading American and European jazz soloists that continued well into the mid to late 90s. And in Rob Pronk's footsteps followed younger up-and-coming jazz-oriented composers and arrangers like Jerry van Rooyen and Henk Meutgeert. All this happened during a period in which the public broadcasting companies, having been a dominant client for 35 years, ordering by far the largest number of Metropole performances, became increasingly less interested, as according to the various radio producers, most of the listeners in the 80s were not in anymore for shows with a large orchestra with or without selected soloists. That in spite of the broadcasting company's attitudes, the Metropole Orkest met with renewed public acceptance was demonstrated when in 1986 the orchest premiered at the North Sea Jazz Festival, where it shared the stage with the famous jazz singer Dakota Staton and jazz icons like saxophonist James Moody and trombone player Slide Hampton. Other featured jazz soloists were clarinetist Buddy DeFranco, saxophonists Bob Cooper, Bill Perkins, Lee Konitz, and Lou Tabakin. Trumpet players like Freddie Hubbard, Clark Terry, Claudio Roditi, and Bobby Shue. But also vocalists and instrumentalists from other musical fields shared the stage with the Metropole, such as, in random order, Jasperine de Jong, Mathilde Santing, Vic Damone, Nana Mouskouri, Karin Bloemen, Madeleine Bell, Simone Kleinsma, Te Lau, and rock and pop bands Gorefest and De Dijk, etc. Add to this the new opportunities created by Van Otterlo's composing new scores for movies and TV series, and it is easy to understand that the horrible news of Rogier facing a terminal disease had a devastating effect on the orchest members. Van Otterlo passed away in January 1988, just 46 years old. Erno Ola, first concertmaster, said, "Rogier was absolutely irreplaceable. The orchest fell into an incredibly deep abyss." What followed was the unhappiest period in the history of the Metropole Orkest, where there was no musical vision, strategy and policy, and a lot of lethargy and bickering on the part of the musicians, who started to behave more like civil servants than as dedicated instrumentalists. It was precisely then, when the Dutch Parliament was about to discuss a new plan for the nation's symphonic orchestras, including those considered to be part of the Dutch public radio broadcasting system, that the Minister for Education, Culture and Science gave permission to the Metropole Orkest to appoint a new chief conductor. Somebody who should combine musical know-how and wherewithal with enthusiasm and commercial and organizational competence. Someone who could give the orchestra a new lease on life. Dick Bakker turned out to be that person. Dick, for some 15 years, had directed the London Studio Symphony Orchestra, consisting of top freelancers and multifunctional musicians from the London Philharmonic and the Academy of St. Martin in the Fields, and had gathered international fame for his winning 1975 Eurovision Song Festival tune Ding a Dong. The orchestra, members and management were unanimous. Dick Bakker was the ideal candidate and was appointed in 1992. And he knew right away that the Metropole Orchestra could not afford anymore to wait for the public broadcasting corporations to come up with plans and requests for music programs. He and the orchestra had to come up with program concepts themselves. The orchestra would play the lead role. That was the name of the game for the future. And so, for example, a young rapper shared the stage of Amsterdam's pop temple Paradiso with a 52-person orchestra, Scorpio and the Metropole Orchestra directed by Dick Bakker. There was not a disc jockey in sight to scratch vinyl. No, there was an orchestra with a full-blown horn and string section. Press and public alike were astonished and pleasantly surprised. So by the mid-90s, a number of concert series like With a Little Help from My Friends, with metal and heavy rock soloists, Ahoy Concert Hall concerts of Kroener Lee Towers in Rotterdam, the series with Broadway and Hollywood repertoire, American Songbook, and appearances at jazz podia for the International Trumpet Guild Conference, and the North Sea Jazz Festival, with soloists like Herbie Hancock and Eddie Daniels, and the 1995 Ellington Festival led by Gunter Schuller, the celebration that year of Dolph van der Linde's 80th birthday and the 50th anniversary of the Metropole Orchestra, and last but not least, the completely sold-out concert appearance by the Metropole Orchestra at the Herodes Atticus Theatre in Athens at the bottom of the Acropolis, the first half of which was dedicated to movie music in honor of 100 years of cinema, and after the intermission to the music of the great Mikis Theodorakis, who was about to celebrate his 70th birthday.